I want to start talking to you about an incident that changed my life. It was the simple act of learning to drive. And the way I learned to drive taught me that nothing is very hard to learn. And that was a lesson that I confirmed to my satisfaction as a school teacher for 30 years in New York City. That once a kid is tuned to learning, nothing at all is very hard to learn, including advanced calculus. Now, if that seems like a rash boast, I want to remind you that Jaime Escalante, the teacher in California who had the record for the state of California in kids passing the advanced calculus placement test year after year, in fact had an audience exclusively of Mexican immigrants kids and ghetto black kids from Los Angeles. And that year after year, Escalante was number one in the state of California teaching advanced calculus to kids who had never eaten off a tablecloth before and had no tradition whatsoever of scholarship. So when I was 12, I learned to drive, and it caught me by surprise. I was hanging around my grandfather's printing office one day in 1947 when all of a sudden my uncle said to me, "Let's take a Rod Jackson," which is what they used to call me. And the next thing I knew, we were whizzing down the river road across the river from the little town of Monongahela, where Joe Montana grew up, too, in his Buick Roadmaster convertible. He had saved his pay for being in the Army, and he blew it all on this big blue Roadmaster convertible. So we got over on the river road. There was never any traffic over there. And he said, "It's time you know how to drive." I was 12. And with that, he grabbed the back of my neck with his hand, and he forced me to look down at the pedals, and he said, "The square one makes it stop, the long one makes it go. You turn the wheel left when you want to go left, right when you want to go right." He said, "That's all there is to it. Do you have any questions?" And I was dumbfounded. He said, "Good, that's all there is, let's change seats." So I was terrified, and anyone would be, I think. Now, how did I make out? Well, at first I would weave all over my lane and cross the center line, but every time I did that, he cracked me over the head. I stopped doing that. Bud seemed to believe that everyone was born already knowing how to drive, and it didn't seem wise to contradict him. I want to draw an analogy here between the skill of driving, in which your life is at risk from even a momentary lapse of attention, and yet everyone learns conventionally to drive in 20 or 30 hours, and the skills of reading and computer operation, which are physically safe. There's no way to hurt yourself doing that. All three are too easy to learn to make a big deal about. We talk about a national reading emergency in the United States, and yet a Jesuit priest named Paulo Freire would go into the hills in South America and teach farmers who had no tradition of written language at all, would teach them to read in 30 hours. It never took longer than 30 hours, and they were eager students because the very first sentence he taught them to read was, "The land belongs to the tiller." And they learned it instantly, 100%, and they never forgot that. Any expert can tell you that it isn't safe to let 12-year-old kids drive. And yet any expert could also tell you that a 12-year-old couldn't command a warship sailing from the western coast of South America around Cape Horn to Boston. And yet, the very first admiral in the United States Navy, David Farragut, did just that in 1815, took command of a warship, a British prize, and sailed it back with the enemy crew down in the hold, sailed it back to Boston in 1815. Everybody knows that a 12-year-old cannot operate a profitable newspaper, and yet 12-year-old Thomas Edison did just exactly that in the 1860s. He created a newspaper out of an old broken-down press that someone had thrown away that would bring Civil War news to long-distance train passengers. Notice he wasn't competing directly with the big dailies. He was after a very finite audience, a specific audience, and he gave them one kind of news, war news, which he got because the train happened to have a telegraph on it. So they had the news of the battles and the troop movements before the big city newspapers got out. Edison made a small fortune doing that at the age of 12, and he probably would still be doing it, except he was also doing chemical experiments in the baggage car, and he set the train on fire one day, and they threw him off. About a year ago, that would be 1997, a 10-year-old girl was on the front page of the New York Times because she had designed and tested an experiment which seemed to prove that a profitable new medical specialty is bogus. The fellow who repaired the Hubble Space Telescope, you recall a while ago, the thing had an imperfection in the lens, and someone figured out how to send up a corrective lens and repair it. Well, that particular man was driving a tractor all by himself, plowing fields at the age of 5 on his family farm. Now, all these stories challenge our assumptions of what kids can learn. One of the universal marks of an educated man or woman is that they know how to challenge assumptions. They don't believe everything strangers tell them. But schools are unable to help with this challenging of assumptions for fear that we might challenge the very assumption of forced schooling itself. Now, I'd like to tell you a story that I was an eyewitness to. It's 2 years old. In the northeast corner of a famous island, a long way from here, I usually don't tell people what the island is, but since I'm sitting in a church in Nashville, it was Hawaii, and an island where 80% of all the, because I don't want this woman harassed, but I know that church-going people won't do that. An island where 80% of all the employment is working for some level of American government. Did you know that? Outside of the beaches, Hawaii is one of the most depressing places on earth. I mean, the people are whipped and beaten, not the people who pass in and out for a couple of years or the tourists, but the people who live there. They're all government employees. So in the northeast corner of Oahu, a 60-year-old woman sells plates of cooked shrimp and white rice out of an old truck. I mean, the truck has some rust on it. Her truck, including its cooking facilities, is probably worth about $5,000 at most. It's at least a 20-year-old vehicle. Call that her capital investment, $5,000. And I think I'm going to open some eyes about a theme I talked about last night, independent livelihoods, entrepreneurship. Out of this truck, she sells only shrimp and white rice. $9.95 she charges, but it's a big plate of shrimp and it's wonderful. She also sells hot dogs for kids and canned soda. That's it. The license to do this costs this woman $1,200 a year, or a little over $3 a day. She has a high school diploma and a nice smile. Her truck parks on a gravel pull-off away from the main highway in a location where nothing is around, and the only advertising she has is a hand-lettered sign out on the highway that says, "Shrimp Plates, $9.95." The day I stood in line for a shrimp plate, five customers were in front of me, and they bought 14 plates of shrimp and 14 sodas before it was my turn. All those transactions took 12 minutes because I wear a watch. Suddenly, I became intrigued about this humble woman's income. And the next day, I came back and parked where I could watch the truck, but not make the lady nervous. And in 2 hours, she sold 41 plates of shrimp, 41 sodas, and maybe 10 hot dogs. A week later, I returned and watched again, and it was a pretty similar tabulation. Now, my wife is an honor graduate of the famous Culinary Institute of America, and she was nice enough to estimate for me that $7 of the $10.95 was probably profit. Later, I chatted with this shrimp lady in a quiet moment, and I was delighted to discover that she loved to talk about her business. She's out there 56 hours a week. She takes no vacations except Christmas and Easter, and she averages 100 to 150 sales a day, but her record was 350. When she doesn't feel like working, which is often, one of her three daughters takes over. I didn't ask her directly how much she made, but based on what she told me she sold every day and how long it was open, I made a quiet calculation that showed that she must be netting at least a quarter of $1 million selling shrimp out of an old truck. She has no interest in expanding or franchising. And one thing I noticed, all the customers, including me, seemed pleased to be there. They chatted and joked with the proprietor. She seemed happy to be alive, and why not? Now you know something about me driving and something about a shrimp lady on a faraway island. And before we discuss education, I want you to listen to one last story. It's about a 13-year-old Greek-American boy that I'll call Stanley, and since I'm in a church, I'll call him Stanley because that's his name. Stanley only came to school. He was in my class one day a month, and he got away with it because I was his homeroom teacher and I covered for him. I didn't do it to be a lawbreaker, but because Stanley explained to me where he was spending his time, and I agreed with him it was more educational than what went on in school. Seems that Stanley had five aunts and uncles. Every one of them was in business for themselves before they were 21 years of age, and he wanted to follow in one of their footsteps. He didn't know which one. One was a florist, one was an unfinished furniture builder, one a delicatessen owner, one had a little restaurant, and one owned a delivery service. What Stanley did when he cut school was to work for nothing at all for these aunts and uncles, one right after another. He was passed from store to store doing free labor in exchange for an opportunity to learn the business. "Hey, Mr. Gatto," he said to me, "this way I get a chance to decide what business I want for myself. You tell me what books to read, I'll read them. But I don't have time to waste in school unless I want to end up," he actually said, "it's like the rest of you, working for somebody else." After I heard that, I couldn't in good conscience keep him locked up. Learning to drive, making a small fortune doing useful work, learning an independent trade. Did you notice as I was talking how easy all three of these were to learn and to do as long as the learner takes responsibility, keeps an open mind, and has the time and the assistance to get where they're going? It's the time and the right kind of assistance that schooling isn't allowed to offer most of us. And because of its rules, which are made far away from the classroom, it couldn't offer this kind of assistance even if it wanted to. Let's get it clear in our minds that a schooling is not an education. You can easily compensate for lacking a schooling, but there is no way to make up for the damage that occurs without an education unless you're willing to go through grief, struggle, and pain. Without an education, you are simply smaller than you might have been. Plenty of famous and brilliant people have lacked a schooling. George Washington had exactly 2 years, and his school teacher was a convict because nobody else was crazy enough to do that for a living. Benjamin Franklin had exactly 2 years. He was thrown out of both schools that he was in as a troublemaker, although you're going to have to look long and hard before you find a biography that will tell you that. But that's the truth. Admiral Farragut had none. Thomas Edison was. His mother was told that he was feeble-minded and that school would have no use for him. Margaret Mead, the famous woman anthropologist, she was homeschooled, and many more. But all of them had a fine education. So we come to the purpose of this talk, to help you see what an education is. I know the answer for myself, but I'm not arrogant enough to say that it's the only answer. So I'm going to walk you through my own working definition, the definition of the famous Lancaster Amish, and finally, I want you to look at a list of what the 20 finest private boarding schools in the United States ask for from their kids. If you take what you like from each of these examples and mix it with your own wisdom, your own common sense, and your own God-given individuality, I think you'll take away something useful from the time we spend together. First, my own ideas, which I confess I've learned from too many people to thank here. In the beginning of planning a curriculum, I think you need to consider 10 separate kinds of awareness around which self-knowledge and self-awareness are built. The first is a personal reality. We all need to know as much as we can about our relatives and our ancestors. What were their cultures? What are their cultures? What's their situations, their goals, their struggles? Then you need to inventory by carefully testing your own talents and weaknesses, your own limits that come from your biological and cultural heritage. You just need to get a kind of profile of yourself. And it doesn't happen in a week or a month. It's an ongoing thing. I probably spend a little bit of time every day at an advanced age thinking about every single one of my relatives and wondering what part of me I can feel in harmony with that particular person. Then you need to have an intimate knowledge of history. I think you need to know local history, regional history, national history, and global history. I was telling a couple ladies outside today that I forgot to tell the audience here, because I really forgot I was in Nashville, that Andrew Jackson is almost certainly the reason that we have forced schooling in the United States today. Not that he ever would have allowed it. It's simply that a person like Jackson, who drew all sorts of people into his government, who destroyed the banking interests in the Northeast, wasn't going to be allowed to happen again. 1 year after Jackson left office, the Boston School Committee, that really is the genesis of all our woes with schooling, got started up. They wouldn't have dared start up while Jackson was still in office, but 1 year after he left, they started up and hired Horace Mann as their front man. So you really need to have an intimate knowledge of all sorts of history, because it's the tapestry against which your life plays, and it's also a three-dimensional tapestry. I mean, it runs backwards in time, and there are many, many, many examples that are useful to you in deciding what your choices and options are, but only if you know history. Let me tell you why. If I say you don't know history, I don't know whether you do or not, but you as a, you know, a generality. The Germans, the North Germans, the Prussians figured out that people who had a deep understanding of history were dangerous because they could think in contexts. What the Prussians wanted to produce were problem solvers who had no idea whether the problem they were solving was going to make a problem for someone else, like building an atomic bomb. They simply were technicians. And the Germans were wonderful at producing problem solvers. But they said in their private discussions that only one person out of every 200 should be allowed to think in historical context to figure out what the point of solving the problem was and what kinds of ideas it grew out of. Starting about 1917, the teaching of history in the United States was systematically and deliberately destroyed so that you wouldn't be able to step back from your own life and figure out what on earth is going on. On the other hand, I have some good news for you. It's a fairly easy and greatly satisfying thing to self-correct that. So an intimate knowledge of history, that would include political history and cultural history, maybe the history of labor, the history of science and technology, and other relevant forms. That's the second thing. The third is that you need to know the physical world within your reach. You need to know about its geography, its botany, its zoology, its chemistry, its physics. One of the most successful sets of curriculum that I ever administered or designed and administered was supplying each kid with a map of the 12-mile-long island of Manhattan. It's 2 miles wide and 12 miles long. And telling them that by the end of the year, they would have personally and privately explored every zip code zone, I think there were 38 of them, in that confined area, and they would have analyzed the types of business in this particular zip code zone, the housing stock, the dress of the people, and a number of other impressions. Now, what I'm talking to you about is high-powered market research of a type that has immense cash value, especially in a place like Manhattan. But the kids were quite up to that challenge, and we also got into the geography and the botany and the chemistry and the physics of these different places. That's number three. Number four is you need to know enough about the world of work to have an intelligent selection of vocation. When we get to the private schools, you'll find out that is number one, is mastering an understanding of the world of work so that you can match up who you are privately with what. I used to tell kids, you don't want a job that pays well if you're going to be miserable in it, because the money is simply not a compensation for destroying yourself, or if it's antagonistic to your principles or the things that you hold valuable. Number five is that you need to know something about the philosophies and psychologies of human association. You need to know the difference between families and friends, between friends and companions, between companions and comrades. You need to know about collegiality, which is what we use the word networking for today. And you need to know what love relationships ought to be based on the accumulated wisdom of thousands of years of human history and the accumulated wisdom of your own family. That's number five. Number six is you need to understand the intricacies of making a home. Now, I know homeschoolers don't have a problem with this, but usually I speak to non-homeschooling audiences and I say, what a laboratory of everything the home is. It's not an academic exercise, and yet it is an academic. It's both. It's both real life and something that can wonderfully engage the mind as far as you want to carry it. You need to know the difference between a home and just a place to sleep and eat. And boys need this just as much as girls. You need to know the challenges of adulthood in all its ages and what the obligations and duties of a strong man or a strong woman are, what they're expected to shoulder. Number seven is you need to understand the challenge of loss and the great challenge of aging and death. I know that we tend to think of aging and death, depending on whether we're religious or not, in certain ways, but one of the ways I challenged an audience in Boulder, Colorado last fall, who had just heard the Dalai Lama speak, so it was a tough act to follow, let me tell you, I was the next speaker. I said, nothing would mean anything at all if you didn't age and die. If you lived 50 million years, why would it matter that you did anything today or next year or 40 years from now? What would anything matter? We have this wonderful chance to watch ourselves on this circuit and to adapt according to who we are. You're never the same person 2 days in a row. You're always a day older, which means a day wiser if you want to be. And finally, you have to struggle constantly and lifelong, I think, to understand a glimmering of the metaphysical reality, that there are things beyond the physical, things of the soul and the spirit, and no people living on earth at any time in history didn't feel that this was true, but it's not subject to scientific investigation. So once these various awarenesses are awakened, you're better able to see the shape of an educated person as it emerges from the chaos of ignorance. In the first place, an educated person can write their own script or a large part of it. He or she is self-determined. So I think you can see that, that's always a process of becoming. That you never quite get there, but you're always arriving there. You're getting better and better at it. Second, an educated man or woman knows the ways of the human heart so well that they're hard to cheat or fool. Now, I know where I got that from. That's from Thomas Jefferson's diaries. That you know the ways of the human heart so well that you can't be cheated or fooled very easily. Imagine how much grief young people would be spared if they knew that before they arrived at the stage where powerful physical feelings occur, you know, in the later teen years. The third is an educated man or woman, I also got this from Thomas Jefferson, knows their rights and knows how to defend those rights. That's the last thing any school in this country would dream of teaching you, your rights and how to defend your rights. I mean, it'd be a nightmare for them if you knew those things. Number four is an educated man or woman possesses useful knowledge. They know how to build a house or how to write a song or how to make a boat or how to grow food or how to design clothing. They know something real. And if they don't know it, and they want to know it, they know how to learn it, and they have the confidence to learn it. There's a school up in Bath, Maine, called the Shelter Institute, that guarantees you that you will know how to build a 3,000-square-foot, multi-level Cape Cod home in 3 weeks if you go there, because you will build a home in those 3 weeks. If you stay one extra week, they'll teach you plumbing and wiring so you can wire your home. I was a keynote speaker at their 25th anniversary a few years back, and over 500 people came, all with pictures of the homes they built. I mean, there were bus drivers and there were psychiatrists, and every one of the homes was as individual as a fingerprint in 3 weeks. That was number four. Number five is an educated man or woman can form healthy attachments anywhere they go because they understand the dynamics of relationships. I'm not saying it's a desirable thing, but you can extract an educated person and put them down somewhere else, and they'll find their way instead of shriveling up or going to ground. Number six is an educated person can discover truth without following the lead of experts. Not to say that in many cases that is exactly what you do, but you always reserve some skepticism that what you're being told is the whole truth. You know how to compare different accounts. Number seven, an educated person, we never talk about this, has the capacity to create things, new experiences, new ideas. They can make something out of something else, the raw material that's common. Number eight is an educated man or woman possesses a blueprint of personal value. Fortunately, Christians don't have too much trouble with this, but there's an enormous number of people that make up their lives on the spot. They don't have any principles that guide them at all. I mean, an enormous number that I ran into in the classroom. I mean, it's a horrible position to be in. An educated man or woman knows at all times who she or he is. They have a philosophy that's been clarified through trial and error. Of course we make mistakes. We're all imperfect. And you should know that too. But as we strive, we become less imperfect. As long as we remain humble, you can find inner peace. Number 9, and this one is my favorite, is time doesn't hang heavily on an educated person's hands. He or she can be alone. They're not at a loss for what to do with their time. I'll tell you a story, a comparison that interested me. I grew up in several small towns in western Pennsylvania. Monongahela is the one that's closest to my heart. This is the literal truth. I never heard anybody say they were bored until I got away to college. I went to Cornell, and suddenly everybody said it all the time. And yet they were all prosperous and well-favored and well-set out and anointed as the leaders of tomorrow. They were bored all the time. But nobody I knew growing up ever, not one of my parents or relatives, not one of my friends, ever said. So I knew what the word bored meant. It's like a vocabulary word, sort of. I had never felt bored, but, you know, I knew it somehow. Anyway. Time doesn't hang heavily on an educated person's hands. And finally, an educated person understands and accepts why death and aging are necessary. And an educated person learns from each age of their life, even right down to the last age. Now let's shift from John Gatto to the Old Order Amish. They're a group of 150,000 well-mannered, prosperous, law-abiding people who came to America with little more than the clothes on their back. So they didn't have any contacts to make the way easy for them, and they have been persecuted by the state of Pennsylvania, the state of Wisconsin, the state of Ohio for the whole century. So everybody's heard about the Amish, but very few people know the astonishing details, and here they are. Virtually every adult Amisher has an independent livelihood as the owner of a farm or a business. The break is 50-50, and the source of my information is a section at Johns Hopkins University that studies the Amish. There's almost no crime in the community, no violence in the community, no alcoholism in the community, no divorce in the community, no drug taking. There's a little bit of each of those things, but it's so microscopic that when it happens, it makes the front page of newspapers, because it just doesn't happen. Number 3 is they accept no government help with health care, with old age assistance, or with schooling after the 8th grade. And for most of the century, not even that. They were compelled by the government to accept 1 through 8 schooling. Now comes one that should either make you smile or despair. The success rate of Amish in small business is 95%. 1 out of every 20 Amish businesses go bankrupt inside of 5 years. But the success rate of non-Amish business is 15%. That is 17 out of 20 non-Amish businesses go bankrupt in the first 5 years. Number 5 is all Amish children have a chance to take an expense-paid sabbatical year away from Amish life when they arrive at the verge of adulthood, because the Amish don't want someone in the community who doesn't want to be there. They say, how do you know whether you want to be there unless you've tried something else? So they underwrite these excursions all over the country, living among us. There are temporary non-Amish who return. 85% of all grown children prefer to remain close to their parents in the community, and that is a principal reason that this group has grown 3,000% in the 20th century. In the year 1900, there were 5,000 Amish. Now there are 150,000. That's a 3,000% growth. And finally, almost every group member, when interviewed by outside investigators, reports total satisfaction with their lives, whether they're children or adults. A fellow named Donald Craybill of Johns Hopkins University studied Amish businesses. He studied 1,000 Amish businesses for a book published in 1995, which I'll bet will be in the National Library System, called Amish Enterprise, From Plow to Profits. And he had this to say. This is Craybill speaking to you now. They challenge a lot of conventional assumptions about what it takes to enter business. Didn't the lady with the old rusty truck and the high school diploma challenge some assumptions, making her $250,000 a year? They don't have high school educations. They don't have specialized training. They don't use computers. They don't use electricity. They don't use automobiles. And they don't have training in how to create a marketing plan. But the resources that they've transferred over from the farm are these: an entrepreneurial spirit, a willingness to take risks, innovativeness, a strong work ethic, a cheap family labor pool, and high standards of craftsmanship. One of their values is smallness. This is amazing. They have like an unwritten rule that you can't make more than $500,000 a year, not because they have any objection to money, but because in doing that, you blot up opportunities for other people to go into business. So they've got to get along on $500,000 a year. They don't want their shops and industries to get large. This spreads entrepreneurship widely across the whole settlement. What you just heard is a big part of the Amish definition of education, but I'll add a little more. They're legendary good neighbors. They're the first to volunteer in times of crisis in the outside world. They open their farm to ghetto children, and they frequently rear handicapped children from the non-Amish world that nobody else wants. They farm so well and so profitably without using tractors, chemical fertilizers, or pesticides. I mean, is this radical or what? That Mexico, Canada, Russia, France, and Uruguay have hired them to advise those countries on raising agricultural productivity. You can figure out a lot of what an Amisher believes an education is from the things they fought the government about. And one, when the Supreme Court ruled they had to go to school from first to eighth grade, they were prepared en masse to go to prison unless concessions were made. And they won these concessions. They demanded that any school be within walking distance of home. They would not allow their children to be carried on buses. Number two, they refused large schools where pupils were sorted into different compartments and assigned different teachers every year. Three, they demanded that all school decisions had to be signed off by the parents. They demanded a maximum 8-month school year. They demanded that teachers who taught their children be knowledgeable in and sympathetic to Amish values in rural ways. They refused to hand their children over to professional educators. Six, they insisted their children be taught that wisdom and academic knowledge are two different things. Seven, they insisted that their kids have practical internships and apprenticeships supervised by the parents. They were prepared to go to jail and lose everything before they would surrender their children to any form of state indoctrination called schooling, which would break up their families, their traditions, and their communities, and leave their children restless, trained to leap and jump, but without purpose or direction, not knowing where they would land. The Amish realized that new government schools were social separators, built on the principle of mechanical milk separators. They whirl the young mind about until both the social structure of the parents and their coherent consciousness are fragmented. Schools separate children from their personal past and from the past of the culture. Education, as the government called it, separated people from the daily content of life, dividing the world into disciplines, courses, classes, grades, and teachers who remain strangers to their children in all but name. Even religion in a government school, if it was mentioned, would be studied, analyzed, and separated from the family and from daily life. It would become just another subject for critical analysis. Specialists armed with books, separated from the Amish in culture and training, would be entrusted with rearing their children and would encourage their children to liberate themselves from the shackles of home. For what purpose? To jump where? In what direction? Of course, the school, after it breaks your kids away from you, has no idea. And the constant competition, the Amish thought, would destroy many people. It would leave a multitude of losers, humiliated and self-hating, a far cry from the universal strength that Amish community life required. An education to an Amisher is being independent, living in a close community as a valuable neighbor, and living a godly life. On the cusp of the 21st century, where you and I are perched, it hardly seems possible for a definition of education like this to have survived and even thrived. Yet how can we explain the baffling Amish who do it their own way in spite of expert advice and have abundant prosperity and abundant happiness? That the Amish have done so well puts a realistic base of possibility under the ideal of an independent citizenry as the proper goal of schooling. It's something I hope you'll think about. I'd like to offer now a rough three-part division of the basic ideas we're grappling with. First, there's learning. That's the mother concept. And learning will occur naturally whether you want it to or not. That's why wise mothers watch the company their children keep and the situations that they gain experience in. The second concept, schooling, is done in an environment controlled by others, through procedures and sequences more or less controlled by others and for the purposes of others. There's a value to schooling, and I'm of mixed mind. There's a certain group of people who say, well, it shouldn't be called homeschooling. It should be called home education. It's both. There's a value to schooling. If there weren't, we would just all have babies laying around in parks and streets. And there's even a great value when the teachers are people who care for you and struggle to understand you as an individual. But schooling is never enough. The third concept, education, describes efforts that are largely self-initiated internally, of course, for the purpose of taking charge of your life wisely and living in a world that you thoroughly understand. The educated state is a complex tapestry woven out of broad experience, substantial risk-taking, grueling commitments. It's hard work to be educated. It really isn't very hard work to be schooled, even to be brilliantly schooled. You just sort of hand yourself over to other people. And as I say, if they're nice people and they love you, you'll turn out pretty good. Other people will like you. But you can't write your own script then. In this formula that I've given you, learning is something that happens all the time. Schooling occurs when the content of learning is determined externally by other people who impose discipline on the learner, and education is consciously self-determined. It involves building up internal controls over data gathering, judgment, self-discipline, and commitment. I'm sure it's what Inga meant yesterday when she said, you know, you get them on the path, but then you let them walk on that path themselves. It blends information acquired through schooling and accidental learning with a personal purpose. In education, school learning is critically screened and independently verified by each learner before permanent retention. An educated person learns when to trust strangers and doesn't confer that kind of trust indiscriminately. In our own society, schooling, because it's compulsory, is the balance wheel in this child development engine. It can help learning or it can hinder learning. It can encourage education or it can discourage education. I mean, if we had a different form, if I told you what my kids did, it would seem as though I just scattered them like grain to the four winds. But the truth is I had very, very rigorous expectations, and the kid and their parents knew that, and that to get another opportunity, they were going to have to demonstrate to me that some effort had been put out. Every kid perceives, however dimly, the presence of an invisible hand in a school setting, moving with an unstated purpose, as long as that purpose doesn't distort the kid's human nature and seems friendly to learning and encouraging to education, the relationship of a student to schooling develops smoothly. But when a feeling arises that learning is being suffocated and education derailed, the commonest way that happens in a home setting is that you love your kids too much, so you overprotect them, and it suffocates this impulse to take risks and to find out what your limits are, which self-knowledge is the mark of an educated person. Now let's take a look, this will be the fun part, at what the parents at the finest and most expensive private boarding schools in America want from schooling. I've been studying their expectations for 20 years now in order to compare them with my own goals. And I think you'll find this interesting, even if you don't agree with all of it. I'm talking about the 20 ritziest private boarding schools in America, schools like Groton and St. Paul's and Deerfield and Kent. But there are only 20 of them, and some of them say there aren't 20, there are only 18, but 20's around. I'm going to warn you in advance to take careful notice that none of the principles these wealthy parents seek costs a single penny to develop. I don't think they know that. That everybody could do one or all of these things with their own kids just as well as Exeter or St. Paul's could. And I'm going to give you these ideas in no particular order of importance. You decide which of these are important. Elite private schools want their children to learn good manners and to display those manners to everybody, even the humblest person, without thinking about it, so the manners would be reflexive. Now, you might very well want the same thing because it's the proper thing to do. It's the godly thing to do, but that's not why. It's because they know that manners will make their children welcome everywhere, even in strange settings where they're not known. Someone will recognize that this is a well-bred person. Now tell me, and don't answer the question because I know the answer, does it cost anything at all to teach people good manners? I run into ghetto kids who are as mannerly as anybody on earth. All right, the second thing elite private school parents want is hard intellectual knowledge taught to their children undiluted. They don't want it watered down. Now, I never taught any kids younger than eighth graders, but I will tell you that we started in eighth grade with Moby Dick, and as soon as I found out that the school edition had all the hard words and ideas taken out, and I just threw it away and went out and bought enough copies for my kids myself of the real thing. I mean, Moby Dick's as hard a book to read as I think exists. This is your tough book to read. And what I found was after an initial struggle, maybe it lasted 2 weeks, the truth is that the dumbest kid and the brightest kid were thrilled with all these ideas interacting with each other. And they could see the difference between the plot line of hunting a whale and all the ideas that spun out of the interaction of the crew and the officers and the captain with each other. I mean, it was a thrilling thing to do. And the truth is, by that time I'd lived in New York for a while, I was tremendously bored with what they handed me to teach. And I said, well, I never read I was supposed to read Moby Dick in college, but I read the classic comic book and the Cliff's Notes. I said, now's my chance to get paid for reading Moby Dick. And I loved it. I loved it. And then each year we did Moby Dick for about 10 years. And I never got bored. I always found something different in it. So elite private school parents want hard intellectual knowledge taught to their children undiluted. If you were at my talk yesterday, the whole record of the 20th century was taking American children who had proven that they were capable of handling any ideas and slowly breaking their confidence and their parents' confidence and dumbing down the curriculum. It was done so gradually that you don't notice until you pick up, allow me to make this aside, if you pick up a bestseller from 1818, that would be James Fenimore Cooper's Last of the Mohicans, and you make sure that it's unexpurgated, don't get one of the, you will find yourself struggling to read a book that's casting off political and scientific and philosophical ideas. I mean, you got to read about three pages before the arrow gets out of the quiver. That was a bestseller in 1818. It sold the equivalent of 5 million copies of a book today. That would be an outrageous bestseller. It was bought by dirt farmers, and it was read by their kids. Where we have slipped is hard for us to see, because just looking at the previous generation, you can see a little slippage. You've got to go back 100 years. You're going to get some fifth grade textbooks from the 1820s, and you'll discover that what you're reading are college textbooks today. So this thing's been going on for a century, but it's not been going on in these elite private schools that way. And you can correct that. There's a little bit of it. You got to correct it in yourself first. I mean, always go for the hardest, and you'll find in short order, I swear to you this is true, that it isn't very hard at all, but the hardest thing is for you to overcome your fear that you can't do it. That's what Jaime Escalante taught those ghetto kids in Los Angeles. He said advanced calculus is very simple. Now, you might say, well, that's just a nice romantic guy talking, but I once had one of the premier structural engineers on this planet, Mario Salvadori, half a page in Who's Who by this guy, tell me face to face. He said, John, I could teach you the calculus in 3 hours. It's that easy. He said, but you would not believe you could learn the calculus in 3 hours, and therefore in 3 years you won't know it, even though you might be able to pass a test on it. So, you know, we've all been conditioned to being much less than we are. Elite private school parents want their children to be advised only by people that they personally respect and trust. Isn't it madness? Now, none of you are involved in this madness, but isn't it madness that millions of people give their children away to total strangers? They have no idea whether these people are murderers or whether they've been in deep psychoanalysis for 40 years. And it's luck of the draw, you know? It's not one stranger. It's like five or six a day. All right, now let me stop for a second. Have you heard anything yet that sounds like it costs too much money for you to afford? Let me continue. All these things are free. The next thing elite private school parents want is that their children be taught a love and appreciation for the land, for the natural world of plants and animals, not for the scientific knowledge, but because they recognize that unless you have a relation with nature that's easy, your life becomes lonely and barren and abstract. That's why these rich kids ride horses and sail boats. Not for the competitive sport aspect of it, because it puts them in touch with nature. Next, they want their children to develop a public sense of decorum so that they can adapt naturally to every setting they find themselves in without provoking anger or opposition. They want their kids to be knowledgeable enough and sympathetic enough with ways that aren't their own that if they find themselves temporarily among that they'll just relax and enjoy the sojourn. Next, they want a common core of Western culture taught so that all, not so they can pass tests, but so that all the generations, the grandparents, the parents, and the children, are certain to be comfortable with a shared set of ideas and tastes and values. And I'll stop again. There's nothing radical here, is there? And there's nothing that you need to mortgage your home to buy. I have a little bit more. We're almost done. Elite boarding school parents want, this is something that most of us neglect. They want leadership exercises taught to their children as an important ongoing theme of curriculum. They are not interested in their children being part of a managed herd. And fortunately, the leadership exercise, there's a whole section in libraries, and much of biographies contain leadership exercises, how the person learned to lead. For all the, I think correct, I'm not trying to be political up here, but for all the righteous indignation that can be brought against the current president of the United States, what intrigues me is how he learned to master leadership that way, coming from a family in Arkansas. His mother was married 6 times, although only to 5 men, one twice. How did he learn to master leadership if it isn't something that you can study and learn? No, he didn't master it well enough that he's going to get any farther, I think, than last week. I think his days are over. But nevertheless, his command over the affection of most of the American people is a form of leadership itself. And he sort of radiates self-possession, and he broadcasts a certain amount of humility that certainly President Bush didn't broadcast. I mean, Bush was an elitist from Yale, you know, and I have some argument with all the American presidents for the last 10, 20 years. A major concern of boarding school parents is that their children get individual attention. Now, I'm sitting here with people who are masters of that. That their children are in small classes, and by small, I mean 9 or less. Well, I'm sitting here with people who are masters of that. But this may very well not be true of some of you. They want continuous pressure put on their children to stretch their individual limits. That is, if you find 4 or 5 talents emerging, you don't allow the kid to be satisfied with a minimal performance. I know that one of the things ghetto kids love to do, and they do it quite well, is to draw cartoon figures. But what they almost exclusively do is copy the cartoon figures out of the comic book. And when they'd press these drawings on me, because they wanted to be patted on the back, I would pat them on the back, but I would then say, you know, you copied this right out of a comic book, but you didn't see what was there. Every one of your little panels is exactly the same size. I said, look at these comic books. The panels change size according to what's going on in the action of the story. I say, all your hands and arms and heads are inside the frame. Look at the average comic book. A hand will be sticking out of the frame or something. There's a sense of movement and aliveness. And you were sitting there looking at the book, and you didn't see that. Now, suppose I give you 2 or 3 days off school, and you go to the public library, and you simply sit in the art section of the library, and you take down 20 or 30 books, pile them around you, and you find out what these hidden rules are that these comic artists are using, because they were discovered a long time ago, too. So you push kids. Almost everybody has areas of interest. And you push kids in their areas of interest first, and then you might be able to show a kid how one area of interest is related to another. For example, a kid who wants to work in the comic book industry. There are very few jobs for the artists, but there's quite a bit more jobs for the people who write the stories that are put in the speech balloons. And there's even more jobs for the executives who market the books and who do the tie-ins with sweatshirts and hats and stuff like that. So I remember one boy who now has a beachfront home out in Seattle and is very, very successful as an advertising artist now, but he was on the school records as a functional illiterate. And I said, I'll give you time to draw comics if you master the whole industry. I want you to know the economics of the industry, the psychology of the industry. I mean, who buys comics? In what states? I want to see graphs of all the states and how many copies of each title are sold. I was able to work out a completely, without much trouble either, a completely balanced curriculum that took the kid into every area. Okay, boarding school parents again. The schools have had an enormous effect on 20th century society through the efforts of their graduates. Because of that importance, I've reduced the practices in these places to a formula so that you can see clearly that there's nothing they do that isn't easily within your reach. And the formula looks like this at an elite boarding school. The stress is on a disciplined mind that knows itself and knows its limits and knows its strengths. It's on a theory of human nature. That's Thomas Jefferson's understand the human heart so well that you can't be cheated or fooled. A strong knowledge of history, an understanding of the origins of our political and economic and legal system. For example, how did separation of powers develop? So if you take the ideas that make America, you can follow those thematically back in history and actually come to the root, the seed. And you can even go back before then and find earlier attempts to get there that petered out. Separation of powers was directly created because the founders in their debates looked at England and they said that if power resides in one place, no matter how nice the people are, what will inevitably happen is someone will get the power who isn't so nice and then they sweat you. So the whole idea of the United States was to keep power weak. And you did that by making it hard to do anything. So when the newspapers berate you and say, we shouldn't have to work so hard for a national health plan, should just turn this over to experts. Again, it's a form of intellectual treason. The whole idea was that everyone's voice would produce a better result than expert voices would. Not in every instance, but overall. And you can't pick and choose, because once you start taking the power away from people, there's no end to it until they simply are a subject population. And we're close to being that right now. I'd say, just to swell your heads here, I think that the homeschoolers are the most exciting contradiction of the direction of the 20th century that I've ever heard, seen, or read about. That without the slightest bit of assistance, you just grabbed your bootstraps and lifted yourself up. And now that you're substantial enough all over, that you can't be pushed around so easily. So an understanding of where the ideas that ran America came from. There's an emphasis in elite schools on hands-on, face-to-face experience. You never go to a book if you can go to the person who wrote the book, or someone close to that person. You get as close to the origin of the idea as possible. There's an emphasis on writing. I heard Inga say yesterday that homeschoolers read well, but they don't necessarily write so well. At the beginning of every school year, I would tell my kids, who had no tradition of writing at all, none, I would say, look, we're going to start, and every day you're going to write a 300-word, you hear these cries. And I said, no, the average sentence is 10 words long, so it's 30 sentences. It would take you 2.5 minutes to speak 300 words at the speed I'm speaking to you right now. And if I spoke slower, it would take 3 or 4 minutes. But if you can master 300 words, you can handle any kind of letter or brief speech or comment you have to make. But 300 words isn't good. It's good enough for a lot of uses. People who can't handle 300 words just like that are really behind the eight ball. I said, but 1,000 words. They go, nobody can write 1,000 words. And I thought that too when I was in college. How can anyone write 1,000 words? It isn't possible. I'm just remembering. Actually, it was 500 words they said. It took me 6 weeks to write. What 1,000 words is 3 typewritten pages, really. You know, maybe a little bit more than that. If you can write 1,000 words, you can hold your own in any sort of debate. You can write op-ed pieces for the newspaper. If someone says to you, can you do an analysis of the feelings of homeschoolers, if you hand in 1,000 words, anyone would think that's the beginning of a good job. I said, so we're going to start with 300 words until you suddenly see that all your fears are wrong, that when you're jabbering at each other in the playground, I mean, you're getting that 300 words in 3 minutes, that it isn't very hard to do. And then the next thing you're going to see is that 1,000 words isn't very hard to do if you know how to build a structure inside of it. So you put the structure down first, and then you add the words to it. And one of the good ways you can do that is if your kid writes something, you can read it hard, not just read the words, but read it hard and say, I would like to know more about this. Or you say this is true, but you don't say why you believe it's true. There's no evidence here. Rules of evidence. Just by questioning and saying, now just write me, you know, the evidence you have, or just elaborate on where this fella you're talking about came from, or maybe what his parents are like. It's a gradual process, but it's much quicker than you think. The first time somebody writes a 300-word paper that they feel is pretty good when they read it out loud, they really don't have much trouble. They can teach themselves from that point on. The first time somebody writes a 1,000-word paper that they feel comfortable with, they can. And make the writing exercises real. I mean, certainly your kids ought to be corresponding with a few relatives. It makes the relatives feel good. Being a relative, I can tell you, it does that. It's a nice thing to do. It builds bridges to other people. There are letters to be written, not only to newspapers, but surely you want your kids to have some apprenticeships, some contacts with the business world and with the different institutions in Nashville. The right kind of letter, it doesn't have to be very long as it looks right, frequently gets a favorable response. People would say to me, how on earth did you get all these things for your kids? And I said, well, obviously I couldn't have. They got these things for themselves. Well, how did they do that? And I said, they made phone calls, or they had their parents make phone calls, they had me make phone calls, they wrote letters, they stopped by in person, and when the person wasn't in, they left behind a note that testified to the fact that they were on their way to being an educated person. There's so few kids learn this, even in fancy schools, that we had New York at our feet. I mean, I had many, many more things that the kids could have done than I had kids to do them. The adult community, it's true, has been broken of its habit of helping children. But you and I know something. It's built into human nature. It's not hard to reawaken that need to talk to a younger person about yourself or your business or how you do things. It's very easy to reawaken if you go directly to the source and not through official channels. We're almost done here. They want kids at elite schools to develop the power of accurate observation. Now, I'll tell you the simplest way to do that, that for hundreds of years was an important part of the curriculum of important schools all over the world. I was reading an essay written in about 1860 about schooling to people who lived in 1860, obviously, and what it said was that if you can't draw what you see, then you're not actually seeing what you think you're seeing, and that you must let your kids develop a good accuracy in draftsmanship. I mean, they don't have to be Picasso, or oh God knows they wouldn't want to be Picasso. They don't have to be Rembrandt. They have to accurately transcribe what they're able to see. Think of all the rather important jobs that demand that kind of skill, just as a ancillary, as a part of the whole package. I mean, I'm an architect. I'm trying to build a little apartment inside of an old barn so I don't mess up the look of the old barn. It's 100 years old, and I don't think I have the right to do that. And inside of a couple of hours, he had worked out sketches that I could see, I could choose between. I mean, what if he didn't have that ability to do that? Not one of my favorite human beings, but the reason Charles Darwin's book made such an enormous impact was Darwin drew, there are thousands of drawings in the book, and they're not Rembrandt, but they're accurate enough that you can see what the thing is. So developing the powers of accurate observation, it's not a natural thing to do. We don't naturally see what's in front of us or hear what other people say either. So some emphasis on that. The experience with the master creations of music, of painting, of sculpture, of architecture, dance, poetry, the other arts, that'd probably be an easy thing to do around Nashville because there's a tremendous investment here in the arts. And I would add to this, although this came from the private school thing, a familiarity with folk art as well. That is the art that comes from people who don't have their whole lives to devote to some specialty, but still are heartwarming in the expression of their art. I guess Grandma Moses, if some of you are old enough to remember her, who became quite rich and famous on the basis of not knowing perspective, which is common to folk art because, you know, they don't have any academic component. Three more, and we're done. Scientific knowledge of the sky above and the earth below. This one is a big one. Practice in learning how to handle pain. Physical pain, emotional pain, and intellectual pain. If you wonder where the tremendous American interest in sports came from, it comes from the aristocratic boarding schools of England, and it was translated over here, and it was done not to win a game, but to get people familiar with the idea that pain isn't very painful, unless you think it is. Otherwise, it just goes away. The reason that young children were put on horseback and learned to gallop and leap over fences was that it's like driving a car. If you make a mistake, you're dead or you're paralyzed or something awful happens to you. But it isn't that difficult not to make a mistake. If you sail a small boat out of the sight of land, which all small boat sailors are as part of the training, where are you? I mean, all the waves look the same. And if you sail in the wrong direction, I mean, you end up in an awful spot in the middle of the Atlantic. What you learn from these things is that you do have, I'll say, the God-given internal resources, but these people knew that you had the internal resources to overcome these things, that it was only to the common people that they seemed impossible to do. Once you tried to do them, they were easy to do, or fairly easy, as long as you were disciplined. As long as you understood there was danger, as long as you were confident in yourself. Well, you want those things for your children anyway. Now, my kids couldn't afford any of those things. So what we did every year, and the kids did it alone, so they didn't have the I'd start them at the top of Manhattan, and they would walk the 12 miles to the bottom at 3 miles an hour, which isn't a very fast walking pace. It's brisk, but it isn't very fast. It's a four-hour walk. Suddenly, you're free of the need to ride a bus or a subway. If you see that you can get anywhere on foot, it doesn't mean that you won't take a cab or a bus or a subway. It means that you know that it isn't very hard to get around without those things. And what if you're a family of four making $300 a week? And in New York City, to take a bus or a subway is $1.50. It's $1.50 back. So you're talking about you'd need $12 just to go anywhere. Well, in $300 a week, maybe you could afford that once a week. It's just more money. So do you then just sit in your hovel and say, we can't afford to go anywhere? No. If you realize that walking a mile or two or three is nothing, and it's fun, and furthermore, it's healthy. Okay. And the last of the 16 requirements of elite private schools is the development of a determination to demand the highest quality performance from yourself. So what's common in an elite private school is that once a kid's established that they are a crackerjack writer, that's the new base that they have to stand on. So they don't get the easy pats on the back just from trotting out the trick that they've already mastered again. I think that's built into human nature too. We sort of want to do as little as we can get away with and still get the job done. And what we're talking about here is exactly the reverse, that you sit in judgment on yourself and you ask yourself, is that the best I could do? Even if other people say, hey, that was wonderful, and you know that it's a lot less than you could have done, I think you're better off. You won't sink into that slough of tricking other people with less than your best. So we have 5 minutes, don't we? I don't need the notes now. I really wanted to say, do you notice that nothing I thought was an education, nothing the Amish thought was an education, or nothing that the wealthiest people in the country think is an education costs anything at all? 50 million public school children in the United States could be being reared this way. It wouldn't cost anything, and of course that's the rap against it. If it didn't cost anything, I mean, what would happen to all the people who were hired? What would happen to all the book publishers? What would happen to all the builders of school buildings and the sellers of bologna to school cafeterias and things? God bless you all. Good luck. Thank you for coming.